Good morning, it's First Light. Welcome to our gathering around the Word of God today. We're in Genesis chapter 16, and we're looking at this awful situation that Abram and Sarai have created, all because they did not trust God. And so what we're going to look at today is the damage that is done in relationships. So we're in chapter 16. Look with me at verse 3. So after Abram had been living in Canaan for 10 years, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian maidservant, Hagar, and gave her to her husband to be his wife. He slept with Hagar, and she conceived. And when she knew she was pregnant, she began to despise her mistress. Then Sarai said to Abram, "You are responsible for the wrong I'm suffering. I put my servant in your arms, and now that she knows she is pregnant, she despises me. May the Lord judge between you and me." "Your servant is in your hands," Abram said. "Do with her whatever you think best." Then Sarai mistreated Hagar, and so Hagar fled from her. Now I want you to notice in verse 4, Hagar, who is a servant, she begins to despise Sarai now that she has emotionally risen to a higher position in this family because she's now bearing the child of the master of the house, Abram. So she has emotionally risen higher, and now that she is higher than the woman who is technically a master over her, she begins to despise and hate her. And this is obviously not what Sarai intended. Now, there's no indication up to this point that Hagar had been mistreated, and people became servants and even slaves for a variety of reasons in biblical times and even on into history. You can obviously become a slave if someone captures you in battle or some other house. That's normally what we often think of as slavery. But some people willingly take something of that role, as hard as this is for us to imagine, willingly take it on, sometimes for financial reasons. A word that we have come up with in more modern terminology is an indentured servant. The person themselves or their family may have had a debt that they could not pay. And so in order to pay and deal with that debt, they place themselves into this servitude. Or they might go in willingly. There are examples of this in the Bible, of someone who just needs to support themselves and pay their bills and live. And so it's sometimes voluntary. There's no indication. Since she's an Egyptian, let me back up. Since she's an Egyptian, it would appear that she came from Egypt when Abram was there. But Abram didn't fight any battles when he was in Egypt, and so it's unlikely that he conquered her or took her away from somebody. She was acquired somehow. We're not told how. So now that this servant woman, Hagar, is pregnant, she's feeling more powerful than just merely being a servant. She has risen in stature, and she thus begins to despise Sarai. And friends, this is a lesson that we have seen before already in our study of Genesis, the lesson of unintended consequences. Sarai had no idea that things would begin to go so badly and so quickly. The baby's not even born yet. It's only been a few months. And things are already starting to turn out horribly. Friends, that is the nature of sin. When we step out of God's will, we are so often shocked when things go wrong. And they go wrong in ways that we never expected. The lesson of unintended consequences. But I want you to notice again verse 2. So Sarai says to Abram, her husband, "The Lord has kept me from having children. go, sleep with my maidservant. Perhaps I can build a family through her. Now, I want you to notice that this is nothing like our modern technology of what we have commonly called in our day and age test tube babies, meaning that the seeds of life from a husband and a wife are mixed together in a lab, and the egg is fertilized and then implanted ultimately into another woman called a surrogate for the sole purpose of growing this baby and birthing it. In that modern process, which is filled with its own complications, I'm not here to comment on that, but at least that in that situation, the child is actually the biological byproduct of the husband and the wife. This is their child. The method of getting it here is just rather unusual. That is not what's going on here. Sarah's thinking is all twisted if you just think about it, friends. She's thinking that her husband, at her suggestion, can have intimacy with another woman. That woman will conceive a child, will give birth to a child, and then what? And then just hand the baby over to Sarai as if it's now her child? I don't think so. No, that's not going to happen. This child of Hagar will never be Sarai's child. Do you see what I'm getting at? Friends, her thinking is already twisted, and she is setting herself up for failure with this mixed up thinking. But that's the nature of when people obsess over things that they want to change but can't change and struggle to find a way to change it, you find a way to rationalize and trick yourself into believing lots of things. Well, I want you to notice the next thing that went wrong. It's in verse 5. In verse 5, we find these words. That Sarai said to her husband, Abram, "You are responsible for the wrong I'm suffering. I put my servant in your arms, and now she knows that she's pregnant and despises me." So friends, notice she's angry at her husband, and she's blaming him when it was her idea. And so friends, blaming other people for your own errors and sin and mistakes instead of facing your own sin. That is such a common thing. We see it all the time. Every one of us has done it. We're the ones guilty, and we deflect that guilt onto somebody else and blame them. Now remember, Abram agreed with this plan, so he's not totally innocent in all this. But the idea was originally hers, and now she's trying to put all of the blame on Abram, her husband. You know, it seems to me that a better expression of repentance would have been something like this. What if Sarai had come to her husband and said, "Abram, I think we made a mistake. I'm sorry that I originally suggested this idea." Friends, that's a completely different scenario than what we're looking at here. And it would be much more accurate, and it would be a much greater expression of humility. And I'm telling you, a lot of marriages would be in better shape if people had attitudes like I'm suggesting that Sarai could have had in this situation. But we're not finished yet. It gets worse. In verse 6, "Your servant is in your hands," Abram said. "Do with her whatever you think is best." So I want you to notice that in this verse, verse 6, that Abram is emotionally detaching. That's the technical, clinical word that we use. He's basically saying, maybe you've heard these words, "Sarai, you handle it. I'm washing my hands of the whole affair." And of course, what's not spoken here, if we were living out these words, there's a high likelihood we would have struck back verbally at her and said, look, this was your idea. I'm done. You handle it. I'm sick of this. It's not my problem. Do whatever you want, he says. I don't want to have anything to do with it. And friends, I just want you to process and think, when Abram does that, they're no longer functioning as a couple, as a team. They're not working together. They got in this mess together. And a better solution would have been to partner together and try to find a solution together. But the problem is, sin like this gets all gnarled and tangled up and it involves multiple people's lives. And the knots get so tight, it's hard to even unravel things. And so then we get to the rest of verse 6. The rest of verse 6. So with Abram's permission now, you handle it. I'm done. Then Sarai mistreated Hagar. And so Hagar fled from Sarai. Now friends, she mistreated Hagar. Sarai is not acting out of love. She's not acting out of reason. This is pure anger. It is pure spite. It is pure meanness. And nothing good can come of this. And Hagar, she hasn't done anything. You could say, well, she said yes, but she's a servant. She's the one who's being abused in all of this because of the sin of another couple. In fact, when it says that Hagar ran away after all this emotional abuse, at least, maybe even physical abuse, we're not told specifics. When all that was happening and she ran away, let's use a little bit of common sense. Don't you know that's exactly what Sarai wanted? The problem has taken care of itself. She's gone. She wanted the problem to go away, and now it's gone. But look how we got here. Through wicked, mean vindictiveness. Dear friends, be careful of the decisions that you make out of anger and desperation. There is so much pain and turmoil that comes into people's lives, our own, but also the lives of other people. When you decide that a situation is hopeless, then you start acting like the situation is hopeless and start making worse and worse and worse decisions, and pain follows that, friends. Pain for yourself, but also pain for others. Friends, have you concluded with me that Abram and Sarai have done everything wrong in this chapter so far? Just in these first few verses, they have made a mess of things. And what they really needed was patience, to trust God right from the beginning. Well, this is kind of a bummer. This is a low spot to end on, but this is the nature of Bible study. The Bible presents to us the good, the bad, and the ugly, and everything in between. And so our calling is to look at what people do that's recorded for us in Scripture and see what they do wrong so that we can learn and not reproduce their horrible choices. Well, we're not finished with this chapter. We're going to spend some time talking about Hagar now, the innocent person in all this. We'll deal with that tomorrow. Let's pray together. Father, there are people listening right now that know exactly what life becomes like when you make some horrible, terrible, awful decisions. And Lord, I'm praying that we can just repent if that's something we've not done. There may be somebody listening right now. You listen to this story and it brings back names and faces of your own family where you may have behaved badly. And Lord, I'm praying that repentance, true repentance, would come as a result of this, and that we would seek clean hearts and right relationships. Lord, help us to trust you and not be impatient, but to be patient in your calling and in your plan. For we pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen and amen. Well, God's given us another day. Make some good decisions today. Not like the ones we read about today, because God is good all the time. This is First Light.